genetics of ovarian malignancy. I am a hardcore endoscopic surgeon, and I wondered the things which occurred to my mind were like, what is, I mean, I had to think of genes. I had to go back to my school age and think of genes, and I had to, the only thing came into my mind was Angelina's pictures. When this happened in 2013, all of us gynecologists were shaken up, and we were like patients coming and inquiring about, should we get BRCA testing done? So that was the time, again, we went back to genetics. So I had to go back to my biology 8 standard books. So just to explain to you from the very basics, what is genetics and what I'm going to talk about. Do we have a pointer here? Okay. Oh, something moved. Okay. Let's go full, wo kar dijiyega, full screen. So every cell, we have cells in our body, human cells, nucleus, chromosome, and DNA. Next. Okay. DNAs have a structure, double helical structure with all these bases, AGCT, which you all remember as nitrogenous bases. RNA is a single-stranded structure. DNA is a double-stranded structure. Now, the way these genes are arranged, these things are arranged, it forms a gene. Gene, the word means origin. So, if you take this, gene is a word, and the letters which are there, that is the arrangement of these AGCT, the nucleotides which I said. So, unless AGCT is arranged in a particular way, that will not make any sense. If it is arranged in a particular way, it dictates the formation of particular proteins, and these proteins will carry out the enzymatic and the hormonal function. Now, coming to mutations, processes that increase the rate of changes in DNA are called mutations. We have normally all of cells are dividing and there is DNA replication happening. There are errors. Errors occur to an extent of one error in every 10 to million bases. But most of the time, DNA can repair itself. These mutagenic chemicals hamper the repair process. That is why some DNA can change and the resultant protein would be different and the function would be different. We have UV radiations and inherited mutations which can also be passed on to the offsprings. Some of the chemical mutagens, there are a long list of mutagens. Some of the chemical ones which are known as benzene, which is found in industrial as an industrial solvent in the manufacture of drugs, plastics. And then there are a few more. Ionizing radiations which are there in X-rays, gamma rays and alpha particles. Now if you see this particular gene here, it was supposed to be C and G, and if it gets changed to T and A, the protein which was to be here was arginine and here becomes serine. So the resultant function becomes totally different. Cancer is a genetic disease. Why do we call it a genetic disease? Because it is an abnormal, uncontrolled pattern of cell division which is observed. A cancer cell will never produce a progeny of normal cells. DNA damaging agents also increase the risk of developing cancer, and they have a clonal origin. So we have to understand what is genetics and what is hereditary. All cancers have a genetic origin, but most cancers are not inherited. Mutations can happen in germline cells where the gonads are affected, and these defective cells are passed on to the offspring 100%. Whereas somatic mutations happen in only particular cells, so they are not inherited by the offspring. We all have oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes. Oncogenes, which are normally inactive, and when they become active due to some mutation, they start producing cancer cells. Tumor suppressor genes we all have to repair the DNA damages. Whenever they become inactive due to mutations, they can give rise to these cancers. So this is a normal cell cycle. Cell is dividing. If there's an abnormal cell, the tumor suppressor gene will become active and it will kill it. It is only when the tumor suppressor genes becomes inactive due to mutation, the abnormal cell will keep dividing and this will give rise to cancer. Now, we talk of close family relatives. What is a family history? We have to understand first, second and third degree of relatives. First degree is your parents, children and your siblings, your immediate blood relatives. Second degree is your aunts, uncles, grandparents, grandchildren, one generation up, and nieces and nephews. And third degree includes first cousins, great-grandparents and great-grandchildren. There are different mechanisms of gynecological cancers. Germline inheritance is seen in ovarian and endometrial cancers, where we have two main syndromes which we'll be discussing. Hereditary breast and ovarian cancer syndrome and Lynch 2 syndrome. Cervical cancer has an infective origin because of human papilloma virus, and there are sporadic cases as well. So what is why some patients who don't have a hereditary chance of having a cancer, they develop sporadic cases. Wherever ovulation is uninterrupted, whether the woman has not been exposed to OCPs, pregnancy, lactation, they have repeated ovulation, repeated epithelial injuries, and this repair happens by proliferation. Every time there's repair happening of any defect, the cells are exposed to growth factors in follicular fluid, which is a long list of growth factors. And this is an opportunity. Every month, the ovary is prone for mutations to happen. Every month, the repair is happening. There's a possibility of mutations to happen. Coming to our main topic, epidemiology of ovarian cancer. This is the fifth most common cancer among women. And if you see the incidence-wise, the commonest ones are cervical, breast, lung, and then the colon cancers. Rest of the things we know, the median age where they present, sporadic cases present at around 60, and the hereditary present at a younger age, at in the about fifth decade of the life. So one in every 71 women has a chance of developing cancer, which looks really scary. Risk factors are family history. We'll go to the details, age, nulliparity. All these nulliparity and all means long exposure to ovulation, repeated ovulation, early menarche, late menopause, late childbirth, and environmental factors which are not yet very well defined. So now this is the overall incidence of breast of cancers. This all blue is sporadic cancers. They don't have any hereditary predisposition. Only 5 to 10% have a hereditary origin. Out of these 5 to 10%, 70% are due to BRCA1. 20% are due to BRCA2, and others are due to other genes. The small amount is also the Lynch syndrome. What causes HBOC, hereditary breast ovarian cancer syndrome, and BRCA? What is BRCA actually? We all talk of BRCA. BRCA is a short form for breast cancer. BR is for breast and cancer. BRCA 1 and 2, these are two important genes which are involved. They are basically tumor suppressor genes. They are supposed to be active, but because of mutation, if they become inactive, cancer will happen. It's likely to happen, not it will happen. They have a dominant inheritance. I mean, if they are inherited, they have a high chance of producing cancer. They can lead to breast cancer, ovarian cancer. In men also, it can lead to breast cancer, prostate cancer, pancreatic cancers, and melanomas. Now, these are the two main syndromes, as I said. They are responsible for giving origin to epithelial ovarian cancer, not to the non-epithelial ones, and also breast cancer. Whereas Lynch syndrome, you have, this is the defect. There's a defect in the repair mechanism. This gives a combination of colorectal cancers, endometrial cancers, and epithelial ovarian cancers. The non-epithelial cancers, they are not associated with BRCA 1 and 2, but there are other syndromes which may be forming a part of this, such just as Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, where sex cord stromal tumors are found. In this, you find multiple polyps in the digestive tract, and skin pigmentations also are seen in these women. Similarly, Sertoli-Leydig cell tumors, they are also could be a part of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. One important thing to remember is borderline tumors are not due to BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations. So there is no hereditary predisposition when we talk of borderline tumors. There are other genetic syndromes. We need not go to the details. Coming to the main thing, which is hereditary HBOC. This is a simplified version. I'll come to it later in the main chart. Let's talk of BRCA1. What is BRCA1? This is breast cancer gene. The chromosome affected is 17 and the long arm of this is affected. These women who are BRCA1 positive have an 85% lifetime risk of developing breast cancer, 40 to 60% lifetime risk of ovarian cancer, 57% of breast cancer before age 70, and 40% before age 70 for ovarian cancer. Males also have a risk chance of developing breast cancer in such women, and also increasing risk of pancreatic prostatic cancer. This is a graphic representation. If you look at this, BRCA general population is the purple line. This is the general population risk of breast cancer, and this is the BRCA1 positive. Similarly, this is general population for ovarian, and this is BRCA1 positive. So there's a lot of incidence, and these women interestingly have primaries in both breasts. They're not just prone to breast cancer of one breast, but it's not secondary in the other breast. They will have primary in the first breast and the primary in the second breast also. Ovarian cancer risk is high, and men also have an increased risk of breast and prostate cancer. BRCA2 is due to a defect in the chromosome 13, in the long arm 12 and 13. These women have slightly lower risk compared to BRCA1. We'll see this here. Again, comparison. If you see general population breast cancer, BRCA2 positive. General population ovarian and BRCA2 positive. Their incidence of breast cancer is, they don't have an incidence of both-sided breast cancer. Almost 56 to 85% ovarian and male breast cancer as well. So overall, if we see, what are the personal and family history clues that suggest, okay, this could be a patient of BRCA mutation? Early age onset of breast cancer. Multiple relatives with early age onset, like you find time, the gene checking is recommended. Now we have this National Comprehensive Cancer Network, NCCN. They have put in guidelines from 27 world leading cancer centers to look after these patients well for better care of these patients. Though this looks very complicated, but I found it, when you read it, it's so interesting that I did not want to break it and show you. I'll show you this one first. What are the criteria for further genetic risk evaluation? This half, this side half, and this side half is different. This is an individual with a breast cancer diagnosis meeting any one of the following. So a woman sitting across me, she has breast cancer. Whereas that side is an individual who doesn't have breast cancer and she only has history. So there are two different sets of patients we come across. Somebody already having a cancer and she says, what is my risk of BRCA positivity and what is my risk of further cancers? So two of them I'll discuss. I'll also have to read out because I can't remember all this. So this is the patient. There's a known history of mutations in the family. She knows my mother or grandmother had BRCA positive. So she is a candidate definitely for genetic testing. Or there's a history of early age onset breast cancer. Triple negative means these receptors, estrogen, progesterone, and HER2 receptors are negative. These patients are at high risk of developing, of having hereditary breast cancers. Or breast cancer in, at any age in more than one close blood relative. Means if it is, I'll show you for this, I'll show you at second slide, the previous one. Here you see the categories. Breast cancer diagnosed before 45, diagnosed before 50, like little later than 45, but with these additional features, or diagnosed little later but before 60, but with triple negative, the hormones which I said, they're all negative, or diagnosed at any age with all these factors. So I think even if I read out, it'll be difficult for you all to remember. But my stress is early age onset breast cancer, ovarian, invasive ovarian cancer at any age in the family. So this is for the group of women who are carrying breast cancer and they have relatives with this. There's another set of women who have, sorry. This is another group. A patient comes to you, she doesn't have breast cancer, she's asking for advice, should I get myself tested? In her case, the following criteria are to be fulfilled. A close relative with any of the following. Close means first to second degree, we don't go to third degree relatives in this. A known mutation, she's again having a positive mutation known in the family. More than two breast cancer primaries in a single individual. More than two individuals with breast cancer primaries on the same side. Like father's side, there were two women who had breast cancer primaries. And ovarian cancer is irrespective of age. And male breast cancer, again, they give you high, these are high risk factors for doing breast cancer screening, I mean, BRCA screening for these patients. And then there are individuals with a family of different types of cancer. Like there's a history of, normally we ask the history, all general gynecologists like I myself also, your mother, anybody had breast or ovarian cancer, and then we stop. Sometimes they say, ha, my father had cancer. We don't even bother to ask which cancer they had. We need to know there's a family syndromes where prostate cancers, skin, brain, all these can lead to different syndromes where they may fit into. This is just a simplified version of the same. Now, if the patient is positive, okay, like we say this patient has come BRCA positive. Now, what do we do about her? Breast awareness starting at age 18 years. Now, you start her examination, breast examination, every, like biannually or annually starting at age of 25. Between 25 to 29, annual breast, you have to further see it by MRI or mammography, whatever is available. The highest incidence comes after she's 30. So before 30, you can go a little slow, but between 30 to 75, she has a high risk of developing cancer, about 85% chance. Annual mammogram and breast MRI screening, both of them. Before it was either of the two, here it is both. Age more than 75, you can, I'll take some time. I hope this is my last talk. So I'll take some time if you all can bear with me. Because to explain this, it takes time. And it's, I think, important for you all to know. For women with BRCA mutations who are treated, then you can decide further whether to continue MRI. Now, second set is you have to send her to a genetic counselor. Now, protocol principle. Now, what do you do after this? Recommend risk reducing. Counseling may include discussion regarding all this. Risk reducing, selping oophorectomy.
And there's one more lecture after this, so we are running short of time.
Then I can stop it here because it's a very interesting topic and I cannot put it, I think, in 5 minutes. Because I didn't have any videos which I could just run and show. So, these patients, these are high-risk patients and they are recommended RRSO, that is risk-reducing selping oophorectomy once they are 35 and above. This is for BRCA1. For BRCA2, it is a little mild compared to BRCA1, so you can wait up to 45 for recommending this RRSO to these patients. According to NCCN, we have all started doing prophylactic selpingectomy, but according to the cancer guidelines, they say selpingectomy alone is not the standard of care for risk reduction. Although clinical trials are ongoing. They say oophorectomy also should be done. And even if you do selpingo oophorectomy, they are still prone to peritoneal cancers for which you cannot do anything actually, you have to wait. men also should be subjected, men positive for BRCA should also be subjected for self-examination and also for prostate cancers and other. This is all about. And even the risk, you have to see the family tree and the risk to immediate relatives should also be explained. Now, what are the reproductive options? Like a 22-year-old coming, what are her reproductive options? You may suggest her to go for pre-implantation genetic diagnosis to check that the resultant offspring is not affected by the same. Lynch syndrome is, again, it's hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer syndrome, HNPPC, PCC. Here you have variety of cancers. You can have endometrial, ovarian, gastric, hepatobiliary, all these. Most of the times, these patients come for gynae cancers. They don't go for these. So they're earliest detected as gynecological cancers. This happens due to mismatch gene repair. We can cut off this. How do you manage these? You have to be aware of annual colonoscopy should be done in such patients. Transvaginal ultrasound, color Doppler, all this starting at 20, 25 years of age. And for gastric and liver also, you have to do LFTs and others. These are other things which we now... This lady, she created, suddenly all of us again became aware of how to counsel our patients, because patients started coming to us. We didn't know much about genetics at that time. She had her mother and grandmothers all had, grandmother, they all had cancers. And she was BRCA1 positive. So she knew her chance of developing breast cancer was 87%, 50% for ovarian cancer. So she went through self-injectomy, self-oophorectomy and mastectomy bilateral. So what is the risk assessment if we see? If in general population, the risk of developing breast cancer by age 50 is 2%, whereas in mutation carrier, it is 33 to 55%. Same is for ovarian cancer, 2% and 27 to 44%, which is really high. Now, how do you manage these patients? BRCA1 positive, which I showed you in the table, increased surveillance, chemo prevention, prophylactic surgery in these cases. First thing what we say was mutagens. Mutagens are causing mutations which are leading to all this. So beat the mutagens. If we cut the source, how do we beat? Chemical mutations, ultraviolet radiations, they are happening. So we can beat it mainly by increasing the antioxidant intake in our diet, in our fruits, vegetables, and whatever other sources. Active, healthy life, which I will not go into details. One topic of hot topic of discussion is tubal origin of ovarian cancers. That is why we are all doing self-injectomies. This is the epithelial ovarian cancers are supposed to be, they are said to be arising from the uterus and the tubes. Serous, endometrioid and clear cell carcinomas. Their origin is found in the fallopian tube and endometrium and not directly on the ovary. And there are a lot of details about the what kind of evidence we found there. Like this TP53 mutation was there and high grade which was leading to the cancer. Tubal ligation has a protective effect because it doesn't allow the endometrium and the this tubal tissue to come towards the, regurgitate towards the peritoneum. Tubal ligation has a role, self-injectomy has a role. If you are given a choice, don't do just fimbriectomy, do a complete self-injectomy. Risk-reducing surgery, a prophylactic bilateral mastectomy, which is removal of both breasts, can reduce the risk of breast cancer by more than 90%. And this should be done after 30 years of age, because before that, the chances are very low. By that time, you presume she would have finished her childbearing. A prophylactic self-oophorectomy, which is removal of both ovaries and tubes, should also reduce the risk of ovarian cancer by 90%. Just about to finish now. RRS, so what debates are there? And I think if we counsel our patients, they would have a lot of questions, why you want to do my this RRS, so that is risk-reducing self-oophorectomy. Bilateral self-oophorectomy that causes surgical menopause reduces the risk of ovarian cancer, but may increase the chance of cardiovascular disease, osteoporosis, and cognitive impairment. And risk of ovarian cancer after hysterectomy with ovarian, suppose you don't remove the ovaries, she has a risk of developing 0.5 to 0.1 to 0.75% in general population when I'm saying. Death from ovarian cancer chances only 0.03%. So benefit for ovarian conservation decreases, although the benefits decrease with age. After 65, she will have less benefits. So above 65, you can think of removing ovaries. This is, I'm talking of general population. So giving current theories of ovarian carcinogenesis, ovarian conservation and self-injectomy alone may be offered as a better option. It looks like a better option than BSO for ovarian cancer reduction for women undergoing other pelvic surgeries for benign diseases. There are screening tests available like OVA1 and others, TVS, CA125, multimodal, but none of them in ovarian cancer can actually detect it before it happens. OVA1 is nothing but a combination of 5 tumor markers which you get the result through a software, but the specificity is very low with this. ROMA is another test where you take human epididymal factor 4 and CA125 and the menopausal status. But this is meant for patients who are already you are subjecting them to surgery and you want to be sure that only gynae can do it or you want an oncosurgeon also. So they are not tests for detecting ovarian cancer. screening for since most breast cancers and ovarian cancers are sporadic, they are not hereditary. Hence, genetic testing is not recommended only for everybody. It is only for patients who have a strong family history or personal history. What are some of the possible harms of genetic testing? If we are offering it to a lot of women, there's worry about developing. If I'm a carrier, I'll always worry throughout my life, what is my chance of developing this? Guilt about passing on the genes to my family. And insurance companies, they want you to disclose all the diseases which you have at the time when you take insurance. If you are a carrier, you will be treated differently from a woman who's diagnosed with cancer after 50. Now, this is like a practical situation. After all the theory, you would like to know, finally, how do I counsel my patient? A 35-year-old woman, family.
Wind up, please.
Okay, yeah. These are just three case scenarios. How would you suggest them? So again, you have to look, you have to learn this chart very well and then decide. Now, what is the impact of molecular genetics in cancer, gynecological cancer? So ultimately, we want to know what is gene therapy going to be. Here, you take the cells of the patient. And these cells are removed, and then you have virus here from which the DNA is removed. You put in a good DNA and put it inside the patient's cells, put it back, so you allow the genes which you want to, the proteins which were lacking here. The future of genetics would be something like this, where we could be able to play with our genes. This is a video, I would want to skip this, my last slide. This is what Angelina had the message. I do not feel any less of a woman. I feel empowered that I made a strong choice that in no way diminishes my femininity. So I think this should be the message. And with this, I thank you all.
Dr. Jyoti, I'd like to ask one question.
Yeah.
With Angelina Jolie coming in so much of news and everything. First, she was in the news for doing a bilateral breast surgery, then for a second time going through the ovariotomy. Now, again, she's in the news for condemning her ovariotomy, bilateral oophorectomy, salpingo oophorectomy decision. She's saying, what have I done to myself? Because now I've got surgical menopause and all the symptoms associated and everything. So that's again created another hue and cry. Would you like to comment on that?
We have HRT nowadays. See, in Indian scenario, this is not going to happen for many, many years to come. But yeah, if somebody who is well-educated and is BRCA positive may want to go for it. I mean, you would rather live with this HRT rather than die. I mean, when you have a risk of 85% of breast cancer and 50% of ovarian cancer, which is very high risk.
No, I think this is a very, very important topic. That's why specifically I wanted this topic. But unluckily, it has gone to the end of the session. This is something we have to all gynecologists. I have seen that 90-95% of the gynecologists are not really aware of the problems of genetic counseling for any of this malignancy. When a malignant patient comes to you, you need to have a proper genetic counseling of all her first and second degree relatives. We are not actually doing it. We need to change. It's high time that we change and understand this topic very well. Good presentation. So I would like to invite you to Cochin also for this presentation. You will have an audience more than 1,000 there.
Thank you, sir.
And enough time. Thank you so much.
I think there are more and more, some people are going on the other side, right? There are more and more people coming forward for gene mapping. Normal people, no history. They want to find out.
That's coming in very much.
Yeah.
People want to know, understand what are they or what are they going to have. What kind of a person are they? So many things are coming up.
Yeah.
Anyway, lack of time, we'll not.
One thing, Jyoti, I would like to know. See, in young women who know that they are at a higher risk, would you recommend MRI every year? Because most of the time, their mammography will be inconclusive. So annually, MRI?
Those who are BRCA positive, for them, 25 to 30, they can do with MRI or mammography. After 30, definitely MRI every year.
No, but that's what I'm saying.
MRI with ultrasound screening is much better than mammography. We do for affording patients, we don't do mammography. It's an MR mammography, which is the ideal.
MR mammography.
It's only not done because of the cost. Yeah. Otherwise, radiation, everything is much lesser.
Because it'll be sometimes, they'll just... False reassurance that nothing.
I'm very thankful to Nikita and Dr.
Dr. Afi, just a short question, fundamental question. This was advanced thing, but for the practicing gynec, till now we took as a rule of thumb that we removed ovaries in all menopausal patients, post-menopausal patients when we did hysterectomy for benign disease. So. But now recent guidelines for past 4 or 5 years are that don't remove it in an ordinary case up to 65 years. Is anyone practicing that? Because till now,
yeah, we don't remove ovaries in postmenopausal patients also until and unless the patient wants it. We explain to the patient the proper things, and usually patient don't want to remove it because surgical menopause is much more severe than a natural menopause.
No, patient who is already postmenopausal.
That's what menopause itself. If you remove the ovary, it's much more severe symptoms than when the ovary is there. The treatment for menopause is different for a surgical menopause. Surgical menopause is ovary is removed and having menopause, or in a menopausal patient, ovary is removed. The treatment of menopause is different for a surgically removed ovary and menopause, and a patient who is having menopause with the ovary inside.
Right.
So it's not recommended to remove ideally.
So that's the guideline now, that we should avoid it up to 65 years of age.
Yes, okay. Yes, that's what we are doing.